Good morning class. In continuation with the topic in hand that is we started last in the last lecture, pulmonary hypertension. We are left with the management part. That's a very important part of pulmonary hypertension, and we'll just recap whatever we learnt in the last session. I hope I'm audible and you're able to hear. Here properly, I guess. Am I audible? Is it loud and clear? Okay, I'll keep checking on the audio. Meanwhile, we'll start up with our presentation. We'll recap what we learnt in the last session. So, as for the pulmonary hypertension, we knew the pathway and the definition wise. Basically, it's in a broader term, pulmonary hypertension is an abnormal elevation in the pulmonary artery pressure. And basically, it's definition wise, pulmonary hypertension is a hemodynamic and pathophysiological condition where the mean pulmonary artery pressure. This is very important. The mean pulmonary artery pressure more than 25 millimeter mercury, and at rest, that is done by right heart catheterization. So, and the pulmonary arterial hypertension. Don't get confused. Basically, any enhanced mean pulmonary artery pressure more than 22 to 25, it denotes pulmonary hypertension, and the specifically pulmonary arterial hypertension is again a clinical condition with the presence of pre-capillary pH in the absence of other causes of pre-capillary pH, maybe due to chronic thromboembolic pH and other rare diseases. So in pulmonary arterial hypertension, where you will have again a mean arterial pressure of greater than 25, but the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure will be less than 15, and the peripheral vessel resistance will be more than 3 volts. That will be reflected in the coming slides. Definition wise, it's very important the classification of pulmonary arterial hypertension. Over the years, the classification has changed, and this is the new classification which we should mug it up. Type 1 pulmonary arterial hypertension is basically where you have, as I said, there will be elevation in pulmonary artery mean pressure, but the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure will be normal. So that's how it is pre-capillary. As you can see, this is this is the right ventricle, and this is the pulmonary artery going to the. So usually it is pre-capillary. So the causes of type 1, group 1 pulmonary arterial hypertension, you have idiopathic. It is one of the very common causes. This is idiopathic, where you rule out other causes. Then heritable, like as you have read in pathology, certain genetic, like bone morphological genes and certain other genes have been predisposed to this condition. Then exposure to drugs like certain anti-cancer drugs, then amiodarone, and several other drugs which can lead to then even the cocaine is of late it has been one of the major causes of pulmonary arterial hypertension, especially in the drug addicts worldwide. Then so there is an association with the connective tissue diseases, and most importantly scleroderma. And this is associated collagen vascular diseases. Then you have congenital heart diseases. And the association, that is another association of pulmonary arterial hypertension. Portal hypertension, that could be a non-liver portal hypertension, or that is primary portal vein thrombosis, or it can be liver-induced portal hypertension, or HIV infection. Schistosomiasis is one very important infective cause for pulmonary arterial hypertension because of the inflammation taking place in the pulmonary vasculature in schistosomiasis. Then there's something called chronic hemolytic anemia that has these overall, these have in broader sense, these have been grouped together in type 1 pulmonary arterial hypertension. where you have elevation in mean arterial pulmonary pressure with normal pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, and the cause is still not very clear in such cases. The exact pathology is not very pathophysiology is not very clear. And then you have a second group, you have a pulmonary venous hypertension. That is again the group of patient where you have elevation in pulmonary mean pulmonary arterial pressure with elevation in, there you will have elevation in pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, as I showed you this diagram. So there will be problem with the left side of the heart. So then because of the back pressure, this is the left atrium, so there will be pulmonary venous engorgement, and the pressure on the post capillary increase in pressure, and that will gonna inversely increase the pulmonary vascular resistance, and it will increase the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, and eventually the pulmonary mean arterial pressure will be raised. So you can understand this. This is because of the left heart failure, you see pulmonary vein, which the back pressure because of the engorgement or enhanced pressure in the pulmonary veins, there will be increase in the post capillary and the capillary pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, and that will reflect itself in by enhancing the pressure on the pulmonary artery. Now you understand this diagram. So these are the systolic dysfunction of the left side, diastolic dysfunction of the heart, and valvular heart diseases. Mostly the left sided, like atrial stenosis and mitral stenosis, can also lead to increase in pulmonary arterial hypertension. Then you have pulmonary hypertension associated with hypoxic lung disease. Hypoxic lung disease, as the main cause is hypoxia causing vasoconstriction. You have COPD, interstitial lung disease, then sleep disorder, breathing, alveolar hyperventilation disorder, chronic exposure to high altitudes, and the certain development abnormalities. Then the group 4 is very important. This has been classified as 1 due to chronic thromboembolic disease. In a short form is CTED. This is a chronic thromboembolic disease. So there you will have elevation in PA pressure with pulmonary arterial obstruction for more than 3 months, and especially this group is where you use anticoagulants, and it has a very good response to therapy. So that's why it's a very important one. The next is 5 is there are multifactorial and miscellaneous causes, and the actual causation is not clearly and clearly understood. And there's hemorrhagical disorders, myeloproliferative or splenectomy, systemic disorders, like especially most importantly sarcoidosis and vasculitis. So these are the miscellaneous cause. So we talked about the risk factors, then susceptibility on the genetic levels, there's molecular, then molecular level, vascular injuries, where you will have importantly decrease in nitric oxide synthase, decrease in prostacyclin, which are basically anti-inflammatories, and platelet, it inhibits platelet aggregation, then enhance thromboxane production and increase endothelin 1 production. And invariably these endothelin, these cause medial and intimal hyperproliferation and hyperplasia, and there will be smooth muscle hypertrophy and early intimal proliferation. So these are the basic vascular injury and the molecular level injury, and the disease progression will lead to loss of REMS. The end result will be smooth muscle hypertrophy, then adventitious intimal proliferation, and it can lead to in situ thrombosis. So these are the, and maybe some malformation. So the main mechanism is pulmonary vasoconstriction, vascular obstruction, maybe increased blood flow due to the congenital heart diseases, left to right shunt, and loss of pulmonary vascular bed. That is again due to that is ventilation perfusion mismatch or pulmonary parenchymal destructions. So now this is the definition for pulmonary arterial hypertension, mean PAP greater than 25, PCWP less than 15. Molecular abnormalities, we talked about prostacyclin, endothelin, nitric oxide, and serotonin, VIPs, genetic levels, bone morphogenetic protein receptor, and the activin receptor like kinase and endoglin, it has been identified in PH. So, sign and symptoms, we talked about easy fatigability, lethargy, syncope is one of the very important signs, then cough, hemoptysis. And depending on the cause as well as breathlessness is one major cause the patient is presented to you, and usually the patient will come with comorbidities, and since more than 50% of the patients have mostly a left heart failure, but the dyspnea will be mostly seen in patients with PH along with the comorbidities. The symptom will be out of proportion and exorbitant. The breathlessness will be so severe, so you have to suspect PH in such cases. And on examination, you might find accentuation of P2, that is second heart sound, pulmonary component of the second heart sound. Murmurs of tricuspid insufficiency are commonly heard. Pulmonary insufficiency, that's a grand steel murmur, can be heard. Left parasternal heave or presystolic gallop. And as the right ventricle fails, mid-diastolic gallop may be present. And JVP is very jugular venous pressure, distension and peripheral edema will invariably develop. This is the WHO classification of functional status of patients with PH. The only difference between this classification and the New York classification is we have included pre-syncope as one of the manifestation, and you can see usually the syncope will be present in the class 4. And in spite of all the advances and in the field of pulmonary hypertension and research is taking places, everything is, in spite of all that, you see the median survival rate because it's usually low. And most importantly, the patients are diagnosed in the later stage, and the average period of diagnosis can be delayed up to 2 years. So the severity of the symptoms worsen before the actual diagnosis is made up, and even in certain patients with scleroderma, the prognosis is worse than idiopathic pulmonary arterial hypertension, because the progression or the association is very severe in case of scleroderma. Functional class, again, as we talked about the functional, this is the functional class. So the functional class remains a strong predictor of survival and the assessment of therapy. Then another congenital heart disease have a better prognosis than those with interstitial than idiopathic pulmonary arterial hypertension. And cause of death is usually right ventricle failure, which is manifested by progressive hypoxemia, tachycardia, hypotension, and edema. Am I properly audible? Just we'll pause over here and just get to know, am I audible? Are you getting me? I understand it's not such an easy topic, but it's not that difficult either. And it's an important topic, that's the point. Fine. So, the parameters of worse prognosis in cases of pulmonary hypertension, in presence of right ventricle failure or rapid progression of symptoms, syncope, or WHO classification 4, or this is called 6-minute walk test, which is less than 300 meters, or any pericardial effusion. This is important diagnostic prognostic measures in cases of pulmonary arterial hypertension. Diagnostic tests, we talked about ECG. ECG has a sensitivity of 55 and specificity of 70%. It's not very very specific, but anything leading to right ventricular hyperstrain on ECG, like right atrial deviation or P pulmonary, they may be indicative just indicative signs for pulmonary artery hypertension. Then this is the ECG picture of the right axis deviation, right, then P wave in wave 2, you can see the P wave, this is a higher amplitude of the P wave in grade 2. Well, there is an electricity failure, the mic, my slide might click off anytime, so I need to rush up. Just a minute. भैया लाइट जल गई है, अब क्या करेंगे, ये कब तक लेगा बैकअप? तो बैकअप तो बंद हो जाएगा?
नहीं, फिजियो लगे ना सर, वो
अब कब तक लेगा बैकअप?
चलेगा ना
10 मिनट, तो ओनली 10 मिनट्स आई हैव, विल स्ट्रेट अवे गो ऑन टू द मैनेजमेंट पार्ट. So treatment part, since we are in dearth of time, we should finish it off soon. So first of all and most importantly, the identification of the treatment of PH is this. First of all, the it depends on the degree of disease advancement, and because the more advanced is the disease, more severe is the functional impaired, more impaired is the functional status of the patient, less responsive to therapy they are. So baseline assessment of the disease severity should be done, and especially we need since we have classified pulmonary arterial hypertension in different class, so we need to have a class specific treatment as well as the patient with the other comorbidities or the underlying causes, they have to be taken care of. So it's a multi complex situation, and mostly the comorbidities leading into PH is always advanced or a functionally more impaired situation, and so the patient progresses to advanced therapy, which is therapy directed to the PH itself rather than underlying causes of the PH, and the most importantly, what I want to drive across is any cases of pulmonary arterial hypertension, in spite of the disease specific diseases, certain drugs have to be tried, and those are prostanoids, endothelin receptor antagonists, phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitors, or for vasoreactive cases, certain calcium channel blockers can be tried. The really important thing is in certain diseases, like in patient with the left heart failure, with systolic failure, you have to be very careful with certain drugs which can lead to further impairment of the cardiac function and impairment of the ejection fraction. But otherwise, more or less, the therapy is almost the same, especially as except for the these class 4 and class 5 types, where the class 4, as we talked about, you have to initiate anticoagulation, and the anticoagulation, it has a very good response to anticoagulation therapy. And the further class 1, you have a whole bunch of therapy which can be tried in the class 1. So first of all, you will do a baseline severity assessment, which is very essential, and because the response to therapy will be measured as a change from the baseline. So what I'll be your instruments for baseline assessment, first of all will be WHO functional class, which can be symptomatically which can be easily assessed in the OPD, and then you have something called six-minute walk test distance, which should be more than 300 meter, which has a better higher so better functional capacity and greater 6 minute walking distance, you have a better prognosis. Then the condition of the right ventricle function can be estimated by echocardiography. The right heart catheterization must be performed to accurately measure the hemodynamic parameters and confirm the pH exists. This is very important. Again, a very important thing to do a right heart catheterization, because you have to assess for the pulmonary arterial hypertension pressure, then the pendling capillary wedge pressure, peripheral vascular resistance. So that's how you can more easily and more conveniently choose your drugs and initiate the combination therapy. Because as I said, these certain drugs, like in patients with left heart failure, they can add to the insult on the left heart. So you have to be very particular so the right heart catheterization should be a baseline assessment for patients supposed to be in pulmonary arterial hypertension. One important point is that the right heart catheterization is contraindicated in patient with WHO functional class 4 or patients with 6 minute walk test less than 200, or patient with hypoxemia or with SpO2 less than 90%. So unstable patients, or both the patient with who are in under hypotensive or unstable, they are contraindication for right heart catheterization. So primary therapy, as you can see, group 1, there is no effective primary therapy, and the advanced therapy is often needed, that is the combination therapy of, as we talked about, the prostanoids, endothelin receptor antagonists, phosphatase 5 inhibitors, and in vasoreactive cases, certain calcium channel blockers. In group 2, where you have the left heart failure there, so the primary treatment is the underlying heart disease. So this is very important. You usually don't try to avoid certain combinations of drugs which are specific for pulmonary arterial hypertension, but you rather manage the left heart pressure first. Then group 3 diseases, first of all, the treatment of underlying cause of hypoxemia, and that has to be corrected with supplemental of oxygen, and then after that we can think of certain therapies leading for pulmonary arterial hypertension. Then group 4 is one group where the anticoagulation is the primary medical therapy, and surgical thromboendarterectomy has a very good response to thromboembolic obstruction of the proximal pulmonary arteries. So surgical thromboendarterectomy can be used in the selected patient where you have a proximal pulmonary artery thromboembolic obstruction. Then perioperative mortality for this procedure is less than 10%, and less than 5% patient will land up with rethrombosis, mostly in case of surgical thromboendarterectomy. Then group 5 is an uncommon and includes pH of ice, as I said, the multifactorial mechanism. So the primary therapy should be directed at the underlying cause, and then only we can think of pulmonary arterial hypertension specific therapies in these such cases. General measures, like a patient, all patients coming to you with severe breathlessness or even class 3 or certain drugs, especially for left heart failures or compromised left heart function, we can try diuretics to treat fluid retention, and even cases of severe COPDs. So you can use or write involving the right heart failure or in cause jugular venous pressure or with peripheral edema, you can consider diuretics, but it has to be given with caution because of certain side effects like decreased cardiac output, arrhythmias induced by hypokalemia, and metabolic alkalosis. As you must have learned in your pharmacotherapy, then the oxygen therapy is the cornerstone of patients, especially with patients with hypoxemia, those falling under the group 3 pulmonary arterial hypertension. And the oxygen is usually administered at the 1 to 4 liter per minute, and can be oxygen saturation should be adjusted above 90%. And in certain cases, like in that's a reversal of shunt, right to left shunt, where it is called Assenmenger physiology, where the supplemental oxygen will not significantly improve the oxygen saturation of patients. Then digoxin. Digoxin is a very dubious and ambiguous. The clear-cut concrete evidence is not present for the use of digoxin, but it can be used to control the heart rate of patients who have supraventricular tachycardia associated with the RV dysfunction. But its use has not been classified as such. Then anticoagulation can be used for, as I talked about, especially with the group 4 patient with chronic pulmonary thromboembolic diseases. It will, especially for patient with increased risk for intrapulmonary thrombosis or thromboembolism. Those with a dilated right heart chambers, you can even try it on such patients. And with venous stasis and sedentary lifestyle, it is indicated in patients with idiopathic pulmonary arterial hypertension because of, as I said, because of the dilated left heart failure and the sluggishness of pulmonary blood flow that can lead to intrapulmonary thrombosis. So idiopathic pulmonary arterial hypertension, you can try anticoagulation, especially for the drug-induced hereditary cause especially, and group 4 invariably for group 4 pulmonary hypertension. And the there you have several groups of anticoagulants, and one of the choice is warfarin. And the goal for warfarin maintenance and initiation is keeping the INR for around 2 to 2.5. other general measures, that's nothing very very different. It's to avoid pregnancy, especially for patients with pulmonary arterial hypertension, because it's a very compromised situation. Immunization against influenza, pneumococcal, then you will need anesthesia perioperatively. You will try giving epidural anesthesia instead of general, and excessive physical activities to be avoided. Symptom limited activity should be practiced. Then therapy targets for PHR, as I said, they have two kind of. First is the long term anticoagulation, and the second one is pulmonary.
Treatment is long term anticoagulation and pulmonary vasodilation. The pulmonary the long term anticoagulation, as we have already learned. Then pulmonary vasodilation, you have calcium channel blockers, prostacycline, nitric oxide, phosphodiesterase type 2 inhibitors, endothelin receptor antagonists like quercetin and ambrisentan. What is important in calcium channel blockers is usually tried in cases where you wish who are vasoreactive. And vasoreactive is being you try nitric oxide and adenosine. And certain actually the vasoreactive test is done through a right heart catheterization, where you give certain nitric oxide inhalation and certain prostacycline infusion, and you can see for the decrease in pulmonary arterial hypertension or pressure less than 10. So any decrease in pulmonary arterial pressure less than 10, that such patients are vasoreactive. A very small proportion of patients are vasoreactive, and they can be put on calcium channel blocker. So calcium channel blocker, you have a different dosage schedule, and it is mostly important for those acute vasodilative responsive test in PH, where is a very small proportion of patients. and usually you have nifedipine in the dose of 90 to 180 milligram per day, dalcyazine in the certain in the 240 to 720 milligram per day, and amlodipine to the dose of 20 milligram per day. As you can see, only less than 20% of the patient respond to CCBs, and it's not really effective in patients who are not vasoreactive, and especially those bone morphogenetic protein receptors mutation, they do not respond. Side effects: constipation, nausea, headache, rash, edema, drowsiness, low blood pressure. Then prostacycline, especially those prostaglandin synthase expression is reduced in endothelin, especially in the cases of PH. So it is these prostacyclines have a vasodilator and anti-proliferative effects, and the available is epoprostenol. This is usually in the continuous IV form. Tipoprostenol is again a continuous, subcutaneous, or IV, or it is, can be also used in an oral form. Iloprost is again the inhaled intermittent form. Mostly these are especially used for the advanced functional impaired patients or advanced cases of PH, where the functional class 3 or 4 or 6 minute distance, 6 minute walking test distance is less than 300. So usually in the most advanced cases, we can straight away start with prostacycline. It's a positive effect is seen by assessing the improvement in exercise tolerance or measurement of 6 minute walk test distance or hemodynamics, quality of life, and survival is enhanced. Side effects: jaw pain, flushing, nausea, headache, diarrhea, musculoskeletal pain, arrhythmia at the site of subcutaneous infusion, which is very common. Then you have endothelin receptor antagonist. Then you have a specific receptor, endothelin A receptor antagonist, and non-selective AB receptor. What is important over here, the endothelin A receptor A is mostly responsible for proliferative and inflammatory reaction in pulmonary vasculature. So ambrisentan is more specific, and you have non-selective bosentan and mesententan. The mesententan is supposed to be less hepatotoxic. Very important to know, these drugs are very hepatotoxic, so you should have a baseline LFT done. Then bosentan is a, as I said, non-selective endothelin receptor antagonist. It improves hemodynamic and exercise capacity in patients with group A. It's a antagonist for both endothelin receptor subtypes, and it reverses the development of pulmonary hypertension and pulmonary vascular remodeling and right ventricular hypertrophy. The initiation dose is 62.5 milligram bidiurnal dose for the first 4 weeks, and it can, the target should be 125 milligram twice daily. And as I said, its side effects is hepatotoxicity and teratogenicity. The nitric oxide pathway, this is a potent vasodilator of the pulmonary vasculature, is acting through increase in cyclin guanidin monophosphate, and it clearly mainly as a result of degradation of phosphodiesterase 5, and that, so the reduction in the expression of NO synthase has been described as the mechanism associated with the pathogenesis of PH. Currently you have two therapeutic class of drugs which interacts in this nitric oxide pathway. You have phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitor, which decreases cGMP degradation, and soluble guanylate cyclase stimulator, which increases cGMP production, and the name is rosiguat. Then you have certain novel drugs which have been tried, like selective endothelin A receptor antagonist sitasentan, but it has been banned in certain countries because of the certain variable, because of the increased hepatotoxic. The ambrisentan, as you talk about, it is being still under research, but it has been used on a regular basis. Then phosphodiesterase inhibitors, you have sildenafil and tadalafil and vardenafil. So it is already administered cyclic GMP phosphodiesterase inhibitors. It's the approved doses up to 20 milligram TID, but there is a durability effect up to a titration up to 20 milligram TID, or maybe the maintenance 40 milligram dose can be sufficient to maintain. And it is contraindicated with nitrates and nicorandil because it acts on the same pathway, and it prevents rebound pulmonary vasoconstriction too. Tadalafil and vardenafil are the other drugs in this group. One important thing is usually initiating a treatment for class 1, class 2, class 3 or class 4. Basically on class 1 depends on the symptom wise, on the need wise, and we can start with a monotherapy, or we can even escalate combination therapy, especially ambrisentan and tadalafil combination, or any of the other group of drugs like sildenafil, and that can be combined with bosentan. So the different drugs from the different groups can be combined, and usually the dual therapy is better than the single therapy. And the other thing is, for especially for class 3 and class 4, for a very severely symptomatic patients, we can try endothelin receptor, we can try prostacyclines, where you can use the IV infusion epoprostenol or intermittent inhalation iloprost, and that can continue up to 12 weeks, and it can be combined with again with phosphodiesterase 5 of phosphodiesterase 4 inhibitors. Surgical intervention is balloon arterial septostomy, and what we do, we allow for right to left shunting. We actually initiate septostomy, so that we initiate stenting from right to left side of the heart. So that will increase the systemic output. There might, in spite of fall in the systemic arterial oxygen saturation, it will produce an increase in systemic oxygen transport, and there will be decompression of the right atria and the right ventricle, alleviating the signs of right heart failure. And severe IPH even has been a main indicator, other than include PH associated with surgically corrected CSD and CTD, and even in pulmonary capillary angiomatosis. And as you know, in congenital heart diseases or patient falling in for pulmonary hypertension, it's a contraindication for septoplasty. That's why for any VST or ASD, the patient falling for pulmonary hypertension, surgery is contraindication, because this is the physiological way you are inducing a shunt, or this is therapeutically you are introducing a shunt. So the septoplasty is contraindicated in ASD and VSD, so that you can maintain less pulmonary arterial pressure and alleviate the signs of right heart failure by keeping on the right to left shunting and increasing the systemic output. Then the other can be tried modality can be heart to lung transplant, where the survival rate is up to 70% 1 year and 50% up to 5 years, and it can be very effective in any end stage of pulmonary vascular diseases. Other areas of research are gene therapy, serotonin transmitter VIPs, and angiogenic factors, stem cells, IMAT and imatinib. So these are the other therapy which has been for which the research has been undergoing, and we can be very in the recent future it can form a part of they can form a part of the treatment. So this is all about pulmonary arterial hypertension. So quickly you can fire in your queries, because anytime this slide can go off. Want to know anything, please let me know. यू शुड रिमेंबर द स्पेसिफिक मेजर्स फॉर IPH आर लॉन्ग टर्म कैंटिकॉलेशन एंड पल्मरी वेसल डायलेटर्स लाइक कैल्शियम चैनल ब्लॉकर्स, प्रोस्टास्टैटिन, नाइट्रिक ऑक्साइड, एंडोथेलिन पाथवे रिसेप्टर एंटागोनिस्ट. दिस यू शुड ऑलवेज रिमेंबर whenever you are penning down the treatment plan for pulmonary hypertension. Anything specifically you want to know? From next class on, we'll start. We'll take up the topic. Either it will be endocrinology or nervous system. We are finishing up with our pulmonary section, and. In the meanwhile, you can go through the topics which from your standard book, and in the subsequent lecture, you can always fire in your queries regarding to any particular topic, any particular confusion, and in the next 15 days, I would plan up a test for the pulmonary section. If I hope that will give you a time. Topics all for test will basically be pulmonary, the whole section on this pulmonary, all pneumonia, COPD, all the subtopics in the pulmonary section. And maybe I'll give you some more time. You can get through your topics and you can fire in your queries in the subsequent lectures. Thank you, class. Thank you so much for your patient hearing. Thank you so much.